innovation. As a young person, I feel like
science and innovation is very important for this discussion.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi there, I'm going to pull some words from a wise young woman that everyone knows, Greta Thunberg. The fairy tales of eternal economic growth, that's a fairy tale. This is the real subject here, that the last 150 years we've overconsumed. We know this now. And if we don't talk about how we got here, unfortunately we're not going to fix what we have to do to prepare with all the damage. So this young woman, 16-year-old woman, has made this audience come here today. And I do want to acknowledge the people outside too, because I'm a white guy. I want to listen to what they have to say, because we, for far too long, have dictated and not listened. So what they're saying out there is legitimate, and we need to be in solidarity with them, because people are offended. Okay, there's no immigration issue. Pharmaceutical company who paid for that. What the hell does a pharmaceutical company have to do with immigration? That is our system. That is what's broken, and we need to address that. Thank you.
Paul, I am going to ask each of the commissions to stick with the time limits. I know they're short. They're designed to get us through the evening so that we're not here late. And everybody needs to be playing by the same rules if this is going to be a fair debate.
I've learned running for office is about making yourself vulnerable. So I'm going to share something with you that I struggled with. Last night I couldn't sleep because a young woman spoke to me. We were at a debate yesterday, all of us. A young woman approached me at the end of that debate and said she was scared. She was scared of the views that were being raised. She was scared of the rise in white nationalism. And she felt like all of us would have done a better job of standing up, against that. As a queer black man, I too am afraid of all of the conversation and all of the space that we're allowing for parties that are racist and xenophobic. So I really encourage us all to think as a country, as a community, about how we make space available. We need everyone to be a part of this conversation. We need Indigenous people here. We need people who are the most vulnerable.
Said in Montreal is that we need to take this seriously. We need to feel a sense. That's what I've heard from the whole team. So where are we going now, and where do we need to get to? Where we're going now is we continue with the price evolution my government has put in place. Price evolution became in 2008, and vilified from the suggestion under Stefan Diel. Price that will increase every year as it needs to address what is the most pressing issue of our time. We will also continue with a ban and a phase out of coal, something that Liberals did successfully in this province, the first jurisdiction to do so in North America under Dalton McGuinty. Phasing out coal nationally is the next step in that bold plan. We will also continue to work on electrification of vehicles, whether that's transit vehicles or vehicles that you may drive, by putting in place tax credits and supporting vehicle charging infrastructure. We will also support green infrastructure and around the country to ensure that buildings are coming up to code. What we need is further and further ambition. We've now joined a group of 60 ambitious nations, including Norway and Scandinavian nations, by saying we'll get to a net zero carbon economy by 2050. And we'll legislate targets in order to implement that. The best way to do that is by having an external mechanism. And here's where the nonpartisanship happens, because we need an external mechanism to check that. And the NDP is actually suggesting the best method, which would be an accountability office or committee that would oversee coal materials of all stripes. That's the step we need to go to ensure that this plan has teeth and is achievable. Thank you.
Multi-residential buildings, condos and apartments are estimated to make up 40% of GHG emissions in North America. There's a Canadian company here in Toronto called Parity Go. They've successfully reduced GHG emissions by 14 million pounds just by themselves. They retrofit multi-residential buildings. This is innovation. This is a long-term solution, and this is happening in the private sector. Mind you, they may have gotten some public funding. I'm not sure. I haven't done all the research on them. But I would support and help promote companies like this, like Parity Go. They are creating a real reduction in emissions. I would also support companies in BC like Mindset, as in Mindsense. The reason Canada has high GHG emissions per person is because we live in a big and cold place. Of our 1.8% carbon global emissions, they are mostly heating and transportation. I could see an argument of imposing a carbon tax on densely populated areas like Toronto or endorsed provincially, and the People's Party is open to that. However, I ask you the question, how is it fair to impose a federal carbon tax on the many rural Canadian communities across the country when they have no alternative for heating and no alternative for transportation?
Thank you.
point, the economy is fundamentally changing and there's no plan to support this transition. Our plan that includes building 500,000 units of affordable housing, green affordable housing, electrifying our transit fleet, and updating the building code so every new building is net zero. Those are the things that create jobs. So we're pledging to create 300,000 new green jobs to support a just transition to a low carbon economy.
Very important that we protect them, and the Green Party has a plan to do that.
expand federal funding to respond to disasters and to support communities in proactively adapting their infrastructure to withstand floods, forest fires, and other extreme weather events. So when you talk about flooding, what you're also talking about is the inability of all three levels of government to work together. What we've had is extensive pleas by the municipal government, particularly the mayor of the city, reaching out and asking for assistance. We've been ready to provide that assistance, but we've been blocked by Doug Ford. What we've done in response is leapfrog over that level of government with respect to funding through the Low Carbon Economy Fund to ensure that it goes directly to municipalities, it goes directly to homeowners. Things that retrofits to your homes, things that can address what you need to adapt and to be more resilient to flooding dangers. What's bizarre and unfortunate that Mr. Fan is not here is that this is where the rubber hits the road economically with climate change, because it costs money. Flooding is costing you money. It cost this city $1 million in 2013 when it was very, very acute. What we are putting in place is insurance protection plans, home ownership protection plans, that will make people more aware of the homes they're buying and more resilient in terms of responding. I also want to take this time to respond to a couple of things that have been raised. One by Mr. Taylor, when he indicated about fossil fuel subsidies. Clearly we need to get off of fossil fuel subsidies, but everyone in this room needs to understand that there are indigenous communities and northern communities that rely upon diesel right now. They are the beneficiaries of some of those fossil fuel subsidies that some parties would seek to eliminate tomorrow. If we eliminate them tomorrow, we're cutting off an energy source to indigenous people. That is not where we need to be. We need to be listening to indigenous people, responding to their needs, and moving together to get them off of diesel and onto cleaner energy. Thank you.
So I ask for your forgiveness. I ask for the candidates' forgiveness. I did veer away from the format. We were supposed to have a 5-minute debate at the first question. So what I propose is that we do a 10-minute debate covering the two questions, water and climate.
We're on our way. People are engaged. This room is packed. They're going to be rude. on their ability to access food. Wild rice is essential for our Anishinaabe people, and the worms are eating the wild rice as a result of climate change far sooner than it's ready to be harvested, it should be harvested.
I'm gonna give our reef a chance to respond.
Sure, so there's a number of things to respond to. Were the targets used, the conservative targets? Yes, they were, that's a matter of fact. Will we actually attain those targets? All told, all aspects of our plan will reduce 2030 emissions by 232 million tons. That's the equivalent to closing 130 coal plants for 1 year. With respect to the pipeline, let's address the elephant in the room. Was there an intention to buy it at the outset? Of course there was. The actual purchase of the pipeline was done to shore up foreign investment. Well, let's talk about a few premises, and I'll try to do this as quickly as possible. If you agree that we are not getting off of oil tomorrow, then oil is coming out of the ground and it has to move. If it has to move, it can either move by truck, by rail, or by pipeline. Elizabeth May has said our pipeline is the safest way to do it. The pipeline that was approved was part of a package where one was disapproved, the Northern Gateway. The Energy East pipeline fell by the wayside because our conditions were too strict. The one that was approved has 153 conditions attached to it. And interestingly, Mr. Taylor brought up indigeneity. Indigenous communities, much like people in this room, are divided on this pipeline. 43 out of 48 actually approve of it and have signed on to community benefits agreements. The Indigenous Resource Council is looking to purchase it from us and steward the environmental impact as they know best, as people that have been doing that for millennia. Is it a perfect situation? No, it is not. I, on your behalf, along with 30 others in the Liberal Caucus, worked hard to ensure that a condition of the second approval was that every dollar of revenue raised from that pipeline expansion would be diverted towards the green transition. And where do we borrow that model from? Norway. The people that use fossil fuel wealth from the North Sea and divert it into a sovereign wealth fund to fund their green transition. If we are funding green transition, setting more ambitious targets. The 2050 targets are much more ambitious than Harper or anyone else's in passage. They're the most ambitious targets on the planet.
I'm going to ask you to pass it to Nick. So, Nick, I'll get to you right after Greg.
So, under the assumption that this IPCC research that we're going to sink in 12 years, it's very, very scary stuff. So, assuming we completely regulate everything and tax ourselves to death, what if the climate continues to change? What if natural disasters continue to happen? And what if, and I can guarantee this last one, China continues to pump just as much plastic into the ocean and just as much CO2 into the air? It comes out of here.
So happy that this
residential buildings. That takes up 40% of GHG emissions in North America. They are creating the solution. They are reducing emissions right now. How is a carbon tax, that puts tax on emissions, existing emissions, in hopes that we will change our behavior? There's already solutions out there, and the market is there to fulfill these solutions. And I gotta say,
so with respect to the point that Paul had raised with respect to indigenous people, of course, the grass and our situation needs to be rectified immediately. What I will stand by is our record of lifting 87 boil water advisories thus far, and we're on track to lift all by March of 2021. With respect to what Nick had said, with respect to the volume, what is important for everyone in this room to understand is that when Rachel Dolly asked for that pipeline expansion, she put in place a cap on oil sands extraction. Jason Kenney, notwithstanding his bizarre political ideology, has not withdrawn that cap. That cap is calibrated with the Paris targets. Ergo, you can meet the Paris targets with the pipeline expansion. And most importantly, everyone in this room should also understand that parties, including the NDP, do support fossil fuel infrastructure. Jagmeet Singh is on record to say he wants to build a refinery in Alberta, and John Horgan, the premier of the NDP in BC, has indicated he is fully in favor of the Kitimat facility for LNG. Fossil fuel infrastructure, in some respects, is needed to address what is a global problem with global solutions like cleaner energy for Asia, particularly China and India.
So we will. Thank you very much to the candidates, and we'll go back to the format. We'll do a wilderness question and then a 5-minute. I remember this time. 5-minute. When asked about what they love most about our country, Canadians often point to natural beauty, wildlife, and spectacular wilderness areas. Yet we're falling below our international commitments to protect these spaces, and our parks and other protected areas are not funded at the level needed to conserve the diverse plants and animals that live there. A recent study shows that 50% of Canadian wildlife species are in decline. 87% Canadians value the emotional and physical benefits of spending time in nature. However, 82% say that they're concerned that future generations won't have close or easy access to nature. What will you do to protect the quality and quantity of wilderness in Canada? I will start with Nick.
Great, thank you. Okay, I mean, again, here we are. So much to tackle. I mean, wilderness, the issue here mostly has to do with the industry and mining. This is what is desecrating most of our wild areas. And the Green Party has several plans, actually, to mitigate this. And we're talking about, it's really money. So this is about allocating money to specific areas. And so we want to protect a minimum of 30% wildlands in Canada and waterways, for that matter. We're committing $100 million to include indigenous communities to actually who have stewarded this land for right here for 15,000 years. So they have some ways that they can play a part in this as well. We will fully restore the Canadian Environmental Act. That's something that Harper gutted back in, I think it was 2012. So that needs to be restored. We will also increase funding to Parks Canada, which is also good. So there's many measures. Also tree planting, tons of tree planting is what we have to do. There's a lot of wildfires right now are intensifying. So we know this. We want to purchase water bombers, for example, to protect these lands as well. Thanks.
very least, be able to share equitably in the benefits arising from protected areas and should not bear inequitable costs.
So just picking up where Paul left off, that echoes UNDRIP. UNDRIP is something that Liberals backed. Romeo Sagamish and NDP supported the House of Commons. We backed it. It died in the Senate, unfortunately, because Tory senators did not allow it to go through. In terms of, I'll tell you what we've done and what we're planning to do. So what we've done is we've stepped in, what Doug Ford has stepped out. With the 50 million trees, there was a tree planting program, we stepped in and saved that program. In terms of what we've done, we've come up with $3 million into land conservation. We created a $500 million new nature fund. We put a national park in an urban setting. That's the Scarborough Rouge. I hope you've engaged with it and embraced it because it is tremendous. And we built on a great plan that happened during Canada 50 when parks were free. Parks continue to be free for all young people. What we're trying to do is get people to engage with nature. That way they will feel the same urgency of protecting nature. Let's talk about where we are going forward. Echoing something that Paul had said, we are protecting 25% of our land and 25% of our oceans by 2025, 30% by 2030. We are making all of our national parks more accessible. We are ensuring that we will plant 2 billion trees over the next decade. That's 53 for every man, woman, and child in this country. And that will create jobs, but that will also create important biodiversity and habitat. This is a critical, critical issue in terms of addressing the goals that we all have for preserving nature, protecting nature, and preserving what is something that is quintessentially Canadian, which is our engagement with the natural world. But also that people often come to me in my capacity as member of parliament talking about animal protections. And we have banned cetaceans in captivity and shark finning, which is part of that habitat and that wilderness that we all seek to preserve. Thank you.
One of the best parts about Canada has to be the outdoors. I mean, how grateful are we to be a short drive away from Algonquin Park? I do drive a gas car to get there, though, so forgive me. Now, the short answer to your question is we need smart and passionate people taking care of these lands. Whether it's, you know, whether it's national or whether it's privatized, we need smart and passionate people because it's not as simple as regulating and that's going to solve the problem. Do you guys remember the forest fires that happened in California last year? Big forest fires in California, 100,000 acres, claimed 700 homes and 6 lives. Many people were quick to blame climate change, and yes, it is a warm climate. However, there used to be a forest industry, a timber industry, who would take down, you know, timbered land, timbered wood, and yes, they would burn it. But there was more federal and state regulations that drove out this timber industry. And what ended up happening is because of all the timber lying around and all the excess bushes not being taken out by forest management professionals, that is actually what instigated this forest fire, the mismanagement of that. So of course, it's true. My point is we need smart and passionate people who understand the Canadian environment.
Don't you mean you're the corporate party?
Thank you.
Farmers set that on fire.
All right, so we have 5 minutes for debate. And I think we've started with Paul. Yeah, so we're going to start with Paul. And this is going to be much shorter than the last debate segment, so just I would keep the interventions very short. And I'd like to come back to you on as the segment goes through.
One of the things I'll remind folks is that, you know, when it comes to Liberals, you have to be really, really careful to look at the fine print. We'll hear big numbers, we'll hear big announcements, we'll hear about big investments. We heard about the housing strategy. We heard a $55 billion strategy. What did the Parliamentary Budget Officer say about that housing strategy? It's not really, they call it not really a strategy at all because it doesn't support people in core need of housing. $55 billion. David Holchansky, a resident of Parkdale-High Park, also said the liberal housing strategy is not much of a strategy at all. And they're actually spending less than they spent the last 10 years ago. So they're projecting that in the next 10 years on housing,
had this before the commencement point of the PBO's analysis. With respect to electoral reform, this came up in yesterday's debate. I candidly admitted that I was very disappointed in the Prime Minister's decision with respect to electoral reform. What I'll say again tonight is that we need to change our voting pattern. We need to incentivize people to get out there and vote, and we need them to feel that their vote is actually counting for something. The best plan is the one that produces a more diverse panel. As we all know, there are four men up here. We need more women up here. We need more persons with disabilities.
Still a leading cause of death and illness.
these substances have demonstrated links to cancer, genetic damage, developmental problems, chronic illnesses, and many other health effects. These effects are often more severe for children and other vulnerable populations. Our overarching toxics law, Canadian Environmental Protection Act, has not been significantly strengthened in 20 years. What will you do to ensure that Canadians are better protected from the health and environmental impacts of toxic substances? Will you commit to strengthening the Canadian Environmental Protection Act and the Pest Control Products Act?
And we'll start with Paul.
Great. Will we? Absolutely, because we've been updated in over 20 years. We absolutely need to. Everyone, all of us, have a right to a healthy environment. Clean air, water, and land, and we'll enshrine that in law as part of a federal environmental bill of rights. Citizens in more than 110 countries already have similar things, from Argentina to Zambia. Zambia currently enjoy a constitutionally protected right to a healthy environment. And I think we have to remember that this is not new. Environmental rights and responsibilities have been cornerstones of indigenous legal systems for millennia. As our Supreme Court has repeatedly observed, incorporating indigenous law into the Canadian legal system is an important step towards advancing reconciliation.
So the short answer on those questions about the CEPA is absolutely, that's part of our platform. You can review that online. The answer with respect to pesticides is that we need to all be more aware of what we're eating, right? It's just that straightforward. We need to be understanding pest control products are being applied, have more understanding of it, and be more vigilant in our regulation of what those toxins are doing to our bodies. What I can say to you is that with respect to what we've already done about addressing toxicity, there are a large number of things. We are banning single-use plastics by 2021. That is the most ambitious plan of any party, including the NDP. What that does
for
Well, we have to move to zero waste is what we have to do. The Green Party has a national plastic waste strategy, actually, that'll get us there by 2022. That's what we have. In fact, there's great organizations right here in our community that are forwarding great ideas, just like that. If you haven't heard of Ronzi Reduce, this is a few people in our community who've come together, who solicited all the businesses and asked them if we could.
They're distracting us away from the realities of the science. And
Bill was asked whether the FPIC stands for vetoable in the House Standing Committee. He said absolutely it does not. First point. Second point is that we are not debating where we need to get to. We are debating how fast we can get there and what we need to do in the interim. And what I stand by is in the interim, until we can get to 2050, carbon net zero, the most ambitious goal set by any country on Earth, we need to ensure we are generating revenue that will fuel the green transition. And funding the green transition is critical because we need revenue in order to support renewable energy, low carbon economy funds, and the retrofits and the different tax credits that will be made available to get to where all of us want to go. It is a path to get there, it is an ambitious path, it's a path that I believe in and that our government believes in. And the opposite and contrary alternative is really quite dramatic in terms of who else is thinking about leading this country as government on its own. So this is an incredibly important issue, and I would actually point back to the humbercrest initiative and when that was being built, the fact that it was being run on diesel, and the leadership of some of the previous elected representatives in the tribe, which is a combat. We need more electrification of transit systems. One, we need more transit, but the transit we build needs to be clean. And what I would say to you is I would point to what we are doing as a government, what we plan to do going forward. So things like ensuring that there are zero-emission vehicles that are being subsidized by the state, which is what we've done. Done Ford stepped out of subsidizing them. We are subsidizing them federally to the tune of $5,000. We put $310 million to vehicle charging infrastructure. We are building 5,000 vehicle charging stations around the country, because that classic reframe that I hear is that, why would I buy the Volt or the Leaf? Because I can't get from here in Montreal because there's no charging station. We need to correct that. We're also ensuring that schools and municipalities that have fleets of buses to shipping children will actually electrify those initiatives. In terms of reducing the carbon footprint from flying, that is a huge one, and we need to think more creatively about how we do it. How parliamentarians like I do it, in terms of getting from Toronto to Ottawa and using the Via Rail pass instead of flying to get there. Sometimes air travel is required, but we need to minimize it and use carbon offsets. Those are very, very, very critical. In terms of what I was saying, respect to what was previously raised, is that if fossil fuel infrastructure is so anathema, I would just put to Paul quite gently, why is Jagmeet Singh looking to build a refinery in Alberta?
Speaking of jet fuel, I know that Nick mentioned this already, but quite literally the day that the climate emergency was announced, Justin Trudeau flew to Toronto to celebrate with the Raptors. If that's not open hypocrisy, I don't know what is. This is a complicated problem. We have GHG emissions coming from all over the place. Our cars, our buildings. As I mentioned before, not most of it, but 40% of all GHG in North America comes from multi-residential buildings. And as I mentioned, this private company that exists in the market has created a solution that is reducing GHG emissions today. They're called Parity Go. Go look them up, and if you know a property manager, then you can actually try and get them to retrofit your building. I'm not doing that to plug them, but I'm doing that to demonstrate that there are companies out there, there are businesses out there. It's really, if you want to solve, you know, these massive problems and massive challenges of curbing our pollution-heavy lifestyles, we need to look to more than just the government to regulate taxes. We need to invest in different businesses. We need to invest in different companies that are going to try again to find better solutions that are actually going to make a difference. This company is making a difference. Taxing existing emissions, I mean, let's hope we reduce our emissions. Quite frankly, I don't know that many affordable options that I personally can afford to switch my behavior.
Privatization and deregulation is what brought us to here, so what he just said is all BS.
Yeah.
Capitalism doesn't work if it is deregulated. It gives us environmental degradation. It gives us our youth are suffering anxiety and depression at levels that we've never seen before. We have mass extinction, we have wealth and income inequality, we have climate crisis. These are the things that the model that we've been addicted to for so long, this endless growth model, we don't have to go that way. And this is why I'd also like to talk about what we're doing with the Transportation Act. I just had to rebut that for a second. But we want to remove all the internal combustion engine by 2030. We need to do this very quickly. We also want to bring in high-speed rail, a corridor, a triangle from Quebec City to Ottawa all the way to Toronto. We want, and also Edmonton, Alberta as well, Edmonton to Calgary, sorry. What else? There's so much we want to do in this sector. Actually, somebody had mentioned the animal health. Yes, agriculture is so incredibly important. We didn't talk about agriculture that much tonight, but I need to bring it up, because if there are any vegans or vegetarians in the room, we all owe them a great deal of respect, because it's something that we all have to embrace, because that can happen as well. Also the treatment of the animals as well. I mean, there's so many other reasons. Thanks.
Federal leadership on electric.
incentive that the that is currently provided for, so folks can actually afford a zero emission vehicle. Also, support them with charging stations and the like, looking at our fleet and how we can electrify our fleet and also electrify transit across the country by working with municipalities. If we invest in transit and actually work towards making it reliable, dependable, and then eventually free, we are going to be able to convince people to get out of their cars and into public transit.
So, I'm going to shift from not all of the questions that we have submitted by the audience are environmental questions directly, but there were a number of questions that we sort of pulled together from what was submitted, and one of them is on electoral reform. Many Canadians were disappointed in the Liberal decision to abandon the campaign promise of electoral reform. Can you shed light on what your party will do to improve our democratic process?
Pretty sure a book is coming out on how Justin Trudeau apparently fulfilled the most promises of any other prime minister. And of course they break those promises up into like 300 different promises. So what I say is, just the promises that he talked about the most, electoral reform, more open and transparent government, just the promises he talks about the most, those are the ones that ends up breaking. When it comes to electoral reform, the People's Party and myself has no stance on that. I am a human being who's trying to act like a politician. I never would have imagined myself in this position, but you know what? I'm a young man, and I've worked in media. And the reason I'm here is I really feel that our media is really failing us in this country. For example, you saw before this event started. Myself, Maxine Bertie, and the PPC has been grossly mischaracterized. And it's a shame that people are fearful to even have open conversations. And I would say something that happens that's really bad is being fiscally conservative. You know, wanting to save money. It's being like vilified in a sense. That's just my experience.
Whether or not we are going to advocate for electoral reform.
just break this down into two categories, what's already been done. So changes were made to the Unfair Elections Act provisions in CR. Elections Canada can now tell you that it's important to go out there and vote. If you've lived abroad for more than 5 years, you are re-enfranchised. That's a million people. Young people are being encouraged to vote and pre-register as young as 14 in high schools around the country. So when the attorney team, they're automatically on the rolls. We've put more voting stations on Indigenous reserves. We've made accessible balloting and mobile balloting more accessible for people with disabilities. What will I do personally? You've heard me say earlier tonight that I was disappointed in that decision. Long before becoming a human rights constitutional lawyer, I was a poli-sci nerd studying at McGill. And what I believe in is giving reasons for people to vote, not dissuading them from voting, letting them feel their vote counts. It disparages me when people walk into my office, tap me on the shoulder and say, I voted for you, I'm glad my vote counted this time. As if only when you back the winning horse does your vote count. That's perverse, that doesn't get people out there. I actually go much further and propose mandatory ballot like you have in Australia. I will push, and I've already pushed, for the per vote subsidy to be restored. There was a time when people would prop up the Rhino Party, the Cannabis Party, pick your party, only because their vote would contribute to the financial health of that party, so they knew the vote was counting in some way, shape, or form. Again, what I want to see is some sort of system that improves and reflects the actual voting intentions of the communities and helps get people, including vulnerable people, marginalized people, people who can't fundraise, people who face obstacles in terms of even contemplating this idea, getting them at a table like this, potentially presenting themselves as candidates. That's what we need, more diverse people in a more diverse parliament. Thank you. Change the text. automated control system. And this automated control system does exist, but it costs a lot of money. Sometimes that scares people who are legislators, but my job as your MP is to show ambition, whether that's on environmental targets or on rail safety, because this isn't a negotiable issue. But to be frank, this is where the rubber hits the road, because again, if we go back to this premise that the transition to a clean economy is going to take place in the next 2 decades, that oil is coming out of the ground and oil is being shipped. And whether it is shipped by a pipeline, by trucks, or by rail is the choice that needs to be made. I do not want more oil being shipped by rail because of that uptick. So that's a question you all have to ask yourselves and be guided by that going forward. I just want to take a brief moment to respond to the green tech point that was made by Nick. I respect Nick, I respect that as part. The point is not, they are not mutually exclusive about revenue being generated. Can we do it now or can we not invest now in green tech? We are already investing in green tech, such as the law laws, support that we gave for $12 million. That's for green technology with the refrigeration of 300 large-scale refrigerators. We need to do more of it by providing tax credits in our platform for companies that will embrace zero-emitting technologies. Because you're right, it is a major change in our economy that we need to embrace.
So the first thing we won't do is we won't give nominals $20 million to buy fridges. We have people that are struggling and living in places where they don't have access to be able to refrigerate their food. You know, we really have to ask, who does the Liberal government, who do they represent? Giving $12 million to Loblaws, $3.3 billion in oil and gas subsidies last year, I think that's shameful. What we want to do is we want to introduce a wealth tax. So folks with $20 million or more, if that's any of you, we're coming for your money.
biggest bridges in this country. First point. Second point. What I want to see is a just transition for everyone. We've announced one with respect to coal. You heard me talk about the phase out of coal nationally by 2030. We put in place a just transition for coal workers in Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, and Alberta. The anxiety you feel, the anxiety that manifests with the yellow vest movement that starts in France and ends up in Canada, is because people feel financial fear. We need to ensure that those people feel financially secure and are embracing the new technologies. With respect to climate change, I'll actually differ a bit here. Because what we have done is we've recognized that those people most affected by climate change are also the ones that benefit from what we put in place, which is the climate action rebate. So again, we put a tax on carbon pollution, you get money back in your pocket. If you want to drive 3 cars and go off to the cottage and fly around the world, go ahead and do so. It's going to cost you more money. The people that are polluting the least are actually receiving the biggest benefit from that climate action rebate. And how we're going to address those people in poverty is by escalating that climate action rebate so that those people who are polluting the least
So transitioning to green jobs, you know, there are companies out there that exist, like I mentioned, Parity.go, that are making a difference, a real difference in greenhouse gas emissions. There's companies like Beyond Meat Burger, for example. You know, there is a demand for socially responsible and environmentally responsible solutions. And I'm looking at the long term here, okay? I'm looking at the long term. We need long term sustainable solutions. And I think that absolutely there could be some, you know, federal incentives to create green jobs, but we need to be careful about that. We can't just throw a bunch of money to create a bunch of salaries and say, okay, we got some green jobs here. We need to be very mindful of that. And what I would want to do is focus on socially responsible and environmentally responsible businesses that are financially sustainable, and then reward them with more projects, give them financing for more projects, because they have a sustainable model, they've taken the care and time to create the system. And, you know, capitalism got ragged on earlier today. I'm curious, do any of you have a cell phone? Where did you get that cell phone? I mean, capitalism is not the best, but it's the best we've got. It bakes in accountability. The People's Party believes in personal responsibility, individual freedom, respect, and fairness. But for the carbon tax, I mean, why is the carbon tax gonna help those in poverty? A reef says there's a rebate. If the carbon tax is so effective, why even give a rebate if it's such an effective tax to begin with? There's a lot that the PPC wants to do as well to reduce taxes in other ways as well.
So the Green Party didn't want to call it a tax. We called it a fee and dividend back in the early 2000s when we suggested this idea. And for this precise reason, people won't understand it. You put the word tax in it and they think, I gotta pay more. Okay, so what we are going to do for a just transition, we want to put in place a guaranteed living income. This is coming, folks. This will be in everybody's platform in 2023. It's been in our platform for years, but you will see it. A guaranteed living income will give us the stability to transition into the new jobs that we need, so the new training jobs. So we also added free post-secondary education and trade schools and colleges as well, because people need the support on top of that, and we need the retraining and re-education. So, and we could do that, fully costed budget. They said that we couldn't do it, it's fully costed by the Parliamentary Review Office. We'll also add to that national child care, something that was also promised way back in the day, but unfortunately we had the NDP and the Conservatives ganged up on the Liberals at that time, who had just stole $40 million from you and me. It would have $20 million, which we still haven't recovered, by the way. Also, 70% of businesses, by the way, did you know we're small businesses? So I wonder if they're getting any of that that Reef was talking about, you know, refurbishing. You know, how many grocers are closing right now? Tons of them. Even maybe in our neighborhood, grocers are closing because real estate is so high. So they need the help too, not just the Loblaws of the world. Thank you.
If you win the election, will you commit?
Absolutely.
I'll see you there.
Absolutely.
Yes, as this community grows, however, I will talk about climate alarmism in my my closing statement, which is that I will always bring this down, of course.
You have the chance to do that right now, so we will start with the reading visits. The microphone is in his slot. Each candidate has, I keep getting this wrong, 1 minute for a closing statement.
In 2008, we campaigned for a carbon price under Stefanion, and we were vilified for it by Stephen Harper. Having won that election, we would be 11 years ahead of where we are today. Now that we finally have a price on carbon pollution, I am desperate not to lose that price. But that's exactly the choice that is facing you in this election. Only two people have a chance to become Prime Minister on October 21st. So your choice is Justin Trudeau, the person who accepts the science on climate change, who has put in place a carbon price, and has joined Norway's call for zero net emissions by 2050. Or your choice is Andrew Scheer, the person who denies the science, who openly allies himself with Doug Ford, and has vowed that his first act as Prime Minister would be to repeal the price on carbon pollution. We are in the middle of an existential crisis. We need to move forward ambitiously and urgently. A Scheer government, coupled with climate deniers here in Ontario, like Doug Ford, would be a catastrophic step back. On October 21st, I'm asking you to choose to move forward on ambitious climate action. I'm Marie Ferrandi, the Liberal candidate for Parkdale-High. Thank you.
Thank you.
each and every single one of us to be bold, to be ambitious. It requires each and every one of us up here to be bold and ambitious. Our parties may not be perfect, but we actually need to speak truth to those parties and push for the best. We can achieve this. We can do this. We need to do a few clear things. Science-based targets to hold global temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius. And we can do that work tackling climate change while also addressing some of the other major issues that we face. We can be building affordable housing. We can be introducing pharmacare, childcare. We can have the type of country that this Canada can be. Please, Paul Taylor, October 21st.
Any additional funds will be donated to the humbercrest United Church for kindly providing us.